very much. I feel very honored to get to sing this song on the show tonight. And as Mama would say, I hope you get a blessing out of it. The gates and doors were barred and all the windows fastened down. I spent the night in sleeplessness and rose at every sound. Half in hopeless sorrow and half in fear the day would find the soldiers breaking through to drag us all away. And just before the sunrise, I heard something at the wall. The gate began to rattle and a voice began to call. So I hurried to the window, looked down into the street, expecting swords and torches and the sound of soldiers' feet. But there was no one there but Mary, so I went down to let her in. John stood there beside me as she told me where she'd been. She said they'd moved him in the night and none of us knows where. The stone's been rolled away and now his body isn't there. So we both ran toward the garden and John ran on ahead. We found the stone and empty tomb just the way that Mary said. But the winding sheet they wrapped him in was just an empty shell. And how or where they'd taken him was more than I could tell. Oh, but something strange had happened there, just what I did not know. John believed a miracle, but I just turned to go. Circumstance and speculation couldn't lift me very high, 'cause I'd seen them crucify him, and I saw him die. Back inside the house again, the guilt and anguish came. And everything I'd promised him just added to my shame. When at last it came to choices, I denied I knew his name. And even if he was alive, it wouldn't be the same. Then suddenly the air was filled with a strange and sweet perfume. The light that came from everywhere drove shadows from the room. And Jesus stood before me with his arms held open wide. Then I fell down on my knees and I just clung to him and cried. Then he raised me to my feet. And as I looked into his eyes, the love was shining out from him like sunlight from the skies. Guilt and my confusion disappeared in sweet release. And every fear I'd ever had just melted into peace.
Real quickly, I just have to read this. I do have a resurrection message, but of course, as is the custom with me, it is very different than most. So it's not just a standard reading of the resurrection story and, you know, an exegesis on that. So I want to read to you today from Matthew 28. This is not my message, so don't anybody think I'm going to start preaching, although I may. But I just have to include this in our service today. Matthew 28, beginning at verse 1, the Word of God said, "In the end of the Sabbath, as it began to dawn toward the first day of the week, came Mary Magdalene and the other Mary to see the sepulchre. And behold, there was a great earthquake, for the angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone from the door and sat upon it. His countenance was like lightning, and his raiment white as snow. And for fear of him, the keepers did shake and became as dead men. And the angel answered and said unto the women, Fear not ye, for I know that ye seek Jesus, which was crucified. He is not here, for he is risen, as he said. Come see the place where the Lord lay. And go quickly and tell his disciples that he is risen from the dead. And behold, he goeth before you into Galilee. There shall ye see him. Lo, I have told you. And they departed quickly from the sepulchre with fear and great joy. And did run to bring his disciples word. And as they went to tell his disciples, behold, Jesus met them, saying, All hail. And they came and held him by the feet and worshiped him. Worshiped him. Glory. Jesus said to Satan in the wilderness, Thou shalt worship the Lord thy God, and him only shalt thou serve. Yet he received worship of men and never one time said, Don't do that.
That's right. Yes,
if he was only a man, he caught a bunch of giants. Woo! Glory! Hallelujah! If he was only a man, my friend, that would have been sacrilege.
That's right.
He would have been committing abomination.
That's right.
If he were only a man, like the Jehovah's Witnesses tell you.
Yes.
That's right.
Oh, hallelujah. Woo, Jesus. I said, you know, the Jehovah's trying to tell you that when the people called him Lord, that merely meant sir. That was just a title of respect and honor. The angels called him Lord.
Amen.
The angel said to the Marys, Come and see where the Lord lay.
Amen. Amen.
Hallelujah. I'm going to tell you, honey, there's enough proof right here.
Yes. Amen.
Let me tell you who Jesus is.
Yes.
There's enough proof right here. When angels call him the Lord.
Yes. That's
right.
Amen.
Yeah.
My God, have mercy.
Amen.
When he allows men to worship at his feet, then, sweetheart, he must be God.
Amen.
He has to be God. If he were, as the Jehovah say, only a man that God created and there was no divinity in him, then for him to allow anyone to worship him would have been sacrilege and it would have been an abomination.
That's right.
My God, have mercy. Hallelujah. Then said Jesus unto them, Praise God. Verse 10. Be not afraid. Go tell my brethren that they go into Galilee, and there shall they see me. Praise God. That's as far as I wanted to read. I could barely get through that far. Praise God.
Amen.
And of course, had a little shout come on me, broke my glasses. Oh my God. I want to tell you, I love this time of year.
I love what we're celebrating because I believe it in my heart.
Amen.
My Bible tells me that if thou shalt, thank you, if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. Hallelujah. Praise the name of the Lord. That is the litmus test to stand before God righteous. My Lord, have mercy. For our righteousness is, the word of God says, by faith.
Amen.
We do not possess it, Brother Jack, in reality. We possess it by faith. Hallelujah. Amen. Glory to God. Well, I'm telling you, I love this time of year. I love to talk about Jesus coming out of the tomb. If there is anything in this world that I believe today, I believe he's risen. Amen. I thought about it. You know, I've heard all kinds of arguments made about how fake Christianity is, and it was just, you know, the concoction of these men, these 12 men. And I thought, well, I'll tell you, those are 12 men who sure stuck by their story, because every one of them was killed for their faith.
Right.
And some of them died some horrific ways. Not a one of them recanted. There is not a single historian, secular or religious, who has ever claimed that any of the 12 recanted their testimony and recanted their story. Nobody has claimed that. They all acknowledge that glory to God, that Peter went to his grave confessing a risen Christ. Hallelujah. John went to his grave confessing a living Christ. Thomas went to his grave confessing a living Christ. Glory to God. Every one of them, right down to Paul, went to their grave confessing a risen Christ.
Amen.
And then some will tell you that the name of Jesus appears to work in issues of demon possession because the people believe that it'll work. I said, let me tell you something. The name of Jesus has worked for missionaries who went to foreign lands and could not even speak the tongue of the native people. Yet when they came upon a demoniac, that demoniac didn't even know who Jesus was. They didn't even know what that name meant. And yet that name brought victory. That name brought deliverance. That name brought salvation. So honey, it don't have anything to do with somebody believing something in their head and therefore they psychosomatically make it work. No, it works when you don't know it. It works when you don't even understand what it means. It works when it's spoken in a language that you don't speak. Hallelujah to God. Oh, I want to tell you today, he is risen. Amen. The devils know it. And it scares them to death. Amen. My God, have mercy. All right. Well, that's as much as I can go there because I've got a whole message lined up for you in a minute. I want to show you a brief, about a 10-minute presentation on our video. It's not the same one I showed you for our other anniversary, our 10th anniversary. I tried to use different pictures and all. Sadly, we don't really have a lot of pictures from early in the life of this church. I didn't take a whole lot back then because things were not yet digital. You know, believe it or not, things have changed a lot in the last 13 years.
Amen.
Now we take pictures all over the place, you know, using our phones and digital cameras. Right. But when we started the church, you still had to go get your film processed, you know, over at CBS and all that. Right. So I don't have a lot of pictures from those days. But I do have a little presentation that I put together for you. Want to share it with you. This will just kind of show you a little bit, just a tiny piece of the journey of this ministry over the last 13 years. I pray it proves a blessing to you. While you're watching this, those of you who've been with us a while, I want you to think, if you have any thoughts you want to share, think about it. And we're going to give you opportunity right after the video, okay? So maybe the video will stir up some thoughts.
she went to glory. The road would be rocky, the climb would be hard. She said, don't you give up until you reach heaven and proclaim to the Father how he brought you over to get your reward. A true foundation.
Amen. Well, and let me tell you,
those pictures do not even show half the people that have come through this church.
Yeah.
There are so many that we don't have in pictures.
Right.
And, I mean, people that were with us a good while. You know, we don't have any pictures of Emily. You know, we don't have any pictures. I can't think of his name, but that fellow who went to Germany, his job transferred him to Germany, you know, that drove that little Volkswagen thingy. And, you know, we've had an awful lot of people, folks, come through this church in the last 13 years. Literally a couple hundred. We probably had a couple hundred come through this place. There have been times we've gotten up to a couple dozen people coming to church or close thereabouts. And every time we get up to a certain level and we try to make a step forward, like getting a building or something, without fail, people would suddenly start flopping out on us. It happened over and over and over and over again. And I'm going to tell you, when I was pastoring in the mainstream, that was never the case. When we made a positive move, it actually translated to growth. We would gain people from the move. We didn't lose the people we already had, but we would gain people. And I've had people over the years just beg and plead. We were meeting at the Riverson Park. And Penny just sat there and just practically railed me that we needed to get a place of our own. We needed to get a place of our own. And I sat there and just as serious as a heart attack, I said, if I do and you poop out on us, I'll hunt you down. Because we've been through that so many times. What happened? You see, without fail, we've been through this many, many, many times. Folks, you know, if I can say this today, God help me, but I'm going to tell you something. This church is not where it's at today because of the pastor. It's where it's at today because people have not committed themselves to this work like they ought to have. If the people that have been part of this work would have made a commitment to this church, like I've said to you so many times, I'm going to tell you something. We would have easily 200 or 300 people today. Easily. And we would be having church services like you ain't never laid eyes on before. But see, the enemy knows that. And he has tried over and he's been successful. Over and over and over and over again, he has been successful. I've stood in the pulpit and told people, I've looked them right in the eye and told them exactly what Satan would throw at them that would be able to draw them away from the church. And they sat there and looked me right in the eye, and then he did exactly what I said. And they followed by doing exactly what I said they would do. Mm-hmm. You know, watching a video like that when we got to the Our People segment really breaks my heart. Yeah. Because I see people there that I told them, I said, if you don't get your eyes on Jesus and get them off of other people, if you don't quit letting somebody dictate your life and your moves and what you do and how you do it, that person's going to lead you right out of this church and right out of God's plan for your life. And you know what? She still did it. I looked a fellow in the eye and said, I'm going to tell you, all it takes for you is going to be some little boy come walking into your life, some fella, and all of a sudden you'll be out of the church because that's all it's going to take.
Right.
And lo and behold, boom, that's why we don't have that one with us. Am I telling the truth?
Amen.
I'm going to tell you, folks, you cannot build a church. Everybody loves to look at the pastor, and they love the pastor to be committed for life to this work. I'm going to tell you a little secret. The people in the pew need to be every bit as committed as the man in the pulpit. They need to be every bit as committed to the vision that we have for this church. When I resigned my first church many years ago, My grandmother was sad. She really didn't want to see me go. She didn't want to see me leave it. We had such a marvelous move of God, and it was a marvelous church. And I was so proud to be the pastor of it, I couldn't see straight. It really tickled me. Honey, I'm going to tell you, we were known all through the valley. We were known. I grew up in the valley. That was my stomping ground. That's, you know, I knew every business in that area. They knew me. I was scared to death to start a church in my own backyard. You know, the Word of God said, a man's enemies are only going to be those of his own household. Amen. Mm-hmm. And I was scared to death to start a work in my own backyard, so to speak. But God sent His power. And we built a church. And I mean, it was doing marvelous when I resigned. But I had issues I was wrestling with, and I was scared to death. One day I might do something stupid, and everything I worked for was going to crash to the ground. You know, you got to remember all that happened with Jim and Tammy Baker. It happened at the same exact time as I started my first church. And so I was a nervous wreck. I never wanted to bring reproach on the Church of God. I never wanted to bring reproach on myself. I certainly never wanted to bring reproach on the Lord. So I was scared to death. I hadn't done anything, but I was scared to death I might one day in a moment of weakness and, you know, everything bust loose and it be a disaster. And I didn't want that to happen, Brother Jack. But my grandmother said, oh, you know, she felt like I was leaving because the people didn't share my vision. I said, Grandma, that's not the problem. I got news for you. The people sharing my vision in my first church, sweetheart, that was the least of my problems. We started that church with 13 people in the first service. Out of those 13, 8 plus children stayed. 8 adults and 2 children stayed. And when I left that church, 5 out of those 8 were still in it. And I'm going to tell you something, honey. We grew. Every service, our numbers grew. Because everybody was supposed to be there, was there, number one. And when we had visitors, it was always adding to what we already had, if you know what I'm saying. And since I've been doing affirming work, without fail, when we have visitors, half our regular people aren't here. So instead of it being our regular, say, 8 or 10 or 12, whatever, plus visitors, it'd be our regular, we'd have 5 or 6 of them, plus our visitors. So basically, we might run the same number we normally run, if you follow what I'm saying. But we for the life of us, we can't grow. We cannot show positive growth. And I'm not chiding anybody today. I am trying to instruct you, and I'm trying to tell you truthfully, if you cannot make a commitment to be part of this church and tell the devil where to go. There are people that have left this ministry for the stupidest reasons you could ever dream of. And 90% of the time, they never come to the pastor to talk to him about it. They never come to me. They never try to resolve the issue. They just up and leave. And we don't know why they've left. We don't know anything about it. Takes the longest time. If we ever find out, you know, it's years and years later. Now, we've had some leave. I had one young man from Irving that left because of our belief in the oneness of God. Well, I'm sorry, but in a situation like that, I say good riddance. I mean, you're welcome. You can believe any way you want to believe, you're still welcome. But if the line has been drawn in the sand concerning the oneness of God and you don't feel that you want to be part of a oneness church, well, then this is the wrong church for you. Because we're going to preach one God in Christ, and Jesus is His name. That is our message. Amen. All right. Let's move on with the service today. Does anybody have anything you might want to share today? I know I'm kind of springing this on you. I didn't give you advance notice. But anybody that might have something you'd like to share for our testimony? Brother Jack, you want to share something? Come on.
Up here?
Up here.
Yeah. Praise the Lord, everybody.
Amen.
It's good to see the people that's here.
Amen.
It's good to see the people that's here.
Yes.
Because as I was watching that video, it was tearing my heart up too, brother.
Yeah.
Seeing all the faces that have come and gone just since I've been a part
yeah.
of this church.
Yeah.
So sad to see what God would start doing.
Right, right.
And see them just take and throw it all away. They're... Like you, I have a hard time understanding the why of it.
Yeah.
Because one of my favorite songs, and I might wind up singing it here in a little bit, I don't know, is when Jesus came into my life,
yeah,
it did something.
Oh, yes. Amen. Oh, yes.
I've put a lot of personal effort in a lot of the decisions and stuff I've made along the course of my life because of the impact of Jesus coming into my
yes,
life.
Yes.
And I don't understand, and I guess maybe it was because it happened when I, what was the age I was? I was 11 and received the Holy Ghost when I was 13. But at that young age, your mind is so fresh. There's so many things that you're not aware of about life.
Right, right.
And I guess from that point, because of the impact of the Lord in my life and the things I saw Him do over the course of those years since.
Yes.
I can understand that people that come to the Lord at a later point in their life might not be able to relate in the same way. But I still find myself wondering, as good as the Lord is to us, why they would want to walk away.
Right.
And I'm finding it weird, brother, that I'm going off in this vein on this. anyway, I want to say I am so thankful that the Lord put me in this church.
Yes.
Amen.
Those of you that have been with the church since I've been, I say it all the time because it's such an important thing to me. It had such an impact to me. Because for 8.5 years, I didn't have a church I could go to.
Yes.
I loved the Lord, wanted to live for the Lord, wanted to help Him out. I'd try teaching Bible studies with friends and deaf ears. And I had a hard time understanding that. Brother, I understand exactly how you feel. I do. Because to know what I know in my heart
yes.
about the Lord and the things I've seen Him do, the things I've seen Him want to do for others.
Right.
And yet, to see Him not come to the understanding or realization that He wants to do it for
yeah.
them.
Yeah.
That He wants to be one with them. And as I see it going on, I struggle with understanding that. But I love the Lord. I'm so thankful for this church. I'm so thankful for what it's been for me.
Yes.
Because, like I say, for those 8 years when it was just me and God, and I'd heard preached for decades. I'd heard it preached, you know, you can't live for the Lord, you know, without church. And
yeah.
I believe that. But I also know that there are times when you might have to.
Yeah, that's right.
And He will be there.
Amen.
And as long as your heart is right, and
Amen.
As long as your desire is to love the Lord and continue walking with Him, you might go through those times when it might be just you and Him,
yeah.
but when it is just you and Him, He's still just as real.
Oh, yes.
That's right.
And there is a point when, once again, you'll have corporate fellowship with people of like precious faith.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
I so love this church tonight. I'm so thankful for it. And I'm so thankful for what God's doing. And Him just being God.
Yes.
Amen.
Because, first off, were it not for the Lord, there wouldn't be any reason for any of us to be here.
Yes.
Amen.
And there wouldn't be any reason for anybody to be gathering for any church, especially on today.
Yes.
A day that we've set aside to celebrate the reason for our being here.
Yes.
Right.
In
Amen.
The first place.
Right. Right.
For
Amen.
The reason we have to bow on our knees or
yes.
lay in our bed or put on to read our Bibles. First off, we wouldn't even have a Bible were it not for
yes.
The day that occurred to give reason for us celebrating today. You know, that one act, that one act set so many things in motion.
Yes.
And
yes.
Has done so much for so many people that until I get to the other side, I'll never even know existed.
Yes.
But they came to find the Lord for themselves and have been blessed by His goodness in their life.
Right.
And one of these days, they're going to get to tell me all about it.
Yeah.
Amen.
And I'm looking forward to that. You know, brother, I'm looking forward to meeting that great-grandmother of yours.
Yeah.
Oh, amen.
You'll love her.
Amen.
I am looking forward to meeting people that I have absolutely no idea ever existed.
Right, right.
Amen.
Not just the ones that are talked about in this book we read,
and
is preached from. But the most important thing is I'm going to see the one that set it all in motion.
Yes, amen.
That actually said, in 3 days, I'll raise it up.
Yes.
That's right.
And
amen.
He raised himself
That's
up.
Right.
That's
what
right.
The Word of God says.
And I'm looking forward to, you know, not just having him just in me, but, you know, getting to actually take the hands.
Yes, yes.
And to hug the neck and
yes.
walk side by side
Amen.
The body
yes.
that he offered up.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
I'm looking forward to it.
Amen.
But while I'm in my here and now, I'm thankful for this church. I'm thankful for this place. I'm thankful for this period in my life. And I'm thankful for every one of you that are here.
Yes.
I'm thankful for all of those that have come and gone.
Yes.
Because it, in their own way, at their own time, they were an encouragement.
Right, right.
And even though there was ultimately a sense of loss, still, the Lord knows it all.
Right.
Yeah.
And I love Him. I thank Him so much for being my God.
Yes.
Amen.
And I'm so thankful that through the course of my life, He's never left me alone.
Yes.
Amen.
Even in times when I was alone, I wasn't.
Yeah.
Amen.
And I'm thankful He's brought all of y'all into my life.
Me too.
And I am so very thankful to be in this place today because it is a privilege to recognize His goodness and His mercy.
Amen. Yes. Amen. Praise the Lord.
Thank you, brother. Mom?
Mm-hmm.
You want to say something? You?
Mm-hmm. Okay. No, I'm asking him for next. So you can hand off to him directly.
Oh, okay. First of all, I'm going to say on Resurrection Sunday, while Dolly Parton was singing that song, I was so moved.
Yes.
Not just from the truth of He's alive.
Yeah.
But the fact that I love Him.
Yeah.
And I just couldn't help but sit there and bawl at the truth of it, and I thought, oh, Jesus, you know, just say His name, Jesus.
Yes.
And I do look forward to the day, Jack. Of seeing Him, realizing I'm so much closer now than I was before.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
Watching the videos made me think of some of the services we had, some of the miracles that had taken place,
yes.
the prayers that
yes.
were answered,
yes.
the things the Lord had done.
Yeah.
He moved. He had come through for people.
Oh, yes.
And then these same people, you know, it just took something simple and they were gone.
Yeah.
And I thought, you've got to love the Lord
yes,
to stay with Him.
That's right.
That's right.
Rather than hoping, well, let Him do this for me, but I'll think of somebody else.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's sad. But it is difficult, I think, dealing with people whose minds are so on everything else
yes,
today.
Yes, yes, yes.
So I continue to pray for those who
yes,
came through here.
Me too.
I have them on my prayer list, as I call it, but...
Yes.
I pray for them every day, Lord, their souls, you
yeah,
know.
Yeah.
But for the first time, I think, in my life, now I grew up in the same church Charles did, only I grew up first.
Yeah. Love it.
And it wasn't until I started attending the church where Charles was pastor did I hear the good news, finally,
yes.
instead of the condemnation.
Yeah.
And I still hear it. And the truth will resonate with you when you hear the truth.
That's right.
I was a child when I gave my heart to the Lord, and I thought He took it and had to keep me alive anyway, rather than coming into my heart But I realized this after I grew up, just how close he was and how much he was leading me.
Yeah.
Because I didn't fall into certain beliefs that were perpetuated by the church.
Right, right.
I knew there was something wrong and it didn't set right.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm glad the Lord did that. You know, I'm really glad he did. But he kept me through childhood, which was very difficult, and adult years. And he's just kept me, and I am so grateful to him. And I love him dearly, and I want forever to love him forever.
Yes, amen. You can pass on to
Tommy. I'm waiting for him to come and get it. I know how Tommy is.
Oh, she stood down there by the show.
Oh,
it'll be pretty brief anyway, because I knew by the time Jack and she got done.
Oh well, thank you.
Say a lot of similar things. I was going to say, but you know, being that it's the anniversary, I think back, can't help but think back to, you know, when you first started the church at Kid Springs and everything, and you know, given where I was coming from and in my life. To be quite honest, we talked about it. I mainly did it just to support you.
Yeah.
You know? Mm-hmm. And I figured, what's the worst I could do? Right? I mean, seriously, church, you know, if the LGBT community wants a church that they can go to and worship, whether I necessarily agree with it or not, or come to believe it or not, or what have you, what is the worst? It's a positive thing to do, generally speaking, in a human sense.
Yeah.
So I thought, you know, I can do this. And Charles at the time, I felt like he needed the support and he didn't have anyone to start with. So I did it. But, you know, as the services began and I would slowly hear things that were preached and, you know, I have to admit it would ring true what I would hear.
Yes.
But then, you know, for myself, I had to reconcile what I could tell was true to who I was and what I knew and what my experience was.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, dealing with that, we continued and I would see, you know, others come in. We'd start off with really great numbers. As a matter of fact, we started at Kid Springs doing very well. And, you know, probably my worst fear at that time, I remember thinking was, oh, I probably won't be around here too long because I'll never live up to the standard, you know.
Mm-hmm.
I still, where I was, I'd already experienced a number of people that were Christian
mm-hmm.
who, you know, had their standards and I never seemed to meet any one of them, you know. So, you know, I'm looking at how insecure I was with myself and how I just wasn't going to be able to measure up. So, you know, but as time again progressed on into years, I actually got quite an education, you know, because at the same time, while I'm reconciling the truth of the gospel in my life, and eventually, as you all know, I came to the new understanding, a fuller understanding of the Lord and grace and the gospel and what it means for all of us and God's mercy. But at the same time, I got to see people who seemed to want the truth, or acknowledged readily that they were hearing the truth. Many times people would come through and they were
right.
like, man, I've never
Amen.
Heard it that way. And that is
yes.
straight and true. And
right.
without
Amen.
A doubt, they recognized the truth.
Yeah.
Right. Amen.
But yet they chose to allow other distractions to lead them out the door.
Mm-hmm.
Rather than committing to not only the truth of the gospel, but to a ministry that can help spread to others and out of the community.
Right.
When it came down to those choices, people find it very hard to make that choice to live for God and to value the things of God more than the things of the world.
Right.
And the Bible said that was going to be the case at the end.
Right.
So what we're seeing is
the Bible's word.
So, but it doesn't make it any less disheartening sometimes, especially when you work and struggle for so many years to try everything you can to reach a community that desperately needs it, whether they know it or not.
Exactly. Right.
All that to say, I look back over the years and I see all the people that have come through, and like you two have said, you know, we continue to pray that those who have passed through these doors may eventually come back, and I think that some of them will certainly. because the one thing that does not change is they will have heard the truth.
That's right.
And the Bible says that, you know, the gospel will be preached in all the earth before the end comes.
Yeah.
Right.
So people are hearing the word through this ministry, and others
Amen.
Like it, the few others that are out there like this one. So, you know, all I can say is it is an accomplishment to continue in these 13,
yes.
to this 13th year. It just kind of reminds us every year, even more so, that those of us who are a part of the church, that are supporting the church, really need to make a very, very resound commitment, not only to be supportive here in attendance, but in our time, in our efforts to reach out to other people, to encourage
right.
them to come to church.
Yeah.
It's not just about finances. It's not just about
right.
Having a seat, a butt in the seat, but it's about, you know, being vocal to others about what our ministry offers
yes,
and
yeah.
and what it can do to benefit them in their lives. So hopefully another year will go by and we'll make it. We appreciate it. I appreciate
yes,
it. There, like many prophets in the Bible, it was not an easy road for them at all. I
right.
most immediately think of John the Baptist, and I think of the Apostle Paul as well in each of their circumstances. The most difficult, uncomfortable, undesirable conditions you can be in,
mm-hmm.
but you know, in the end, while you know they went on to their where they are when they died. Not that you're gonna die, but obviously they died. But you have to also think about the fruits of their labor,
yeah.
and even once they were gone. They had disciples who continued on, who helped to form the church that came to be the modern day church. So, you know, this ministry is reaching a lot of people.
Amen.
Who knows? Some you'll know you've affected, others you'll never know.
Amen.
This ministry will never hear
Amen.
Back.
Yeah.
Amen.
But out there somewhere, people are hearing the truth and are recognizing
yes.
it and will one day make a move closer to the Lord and closer to
yes,
enlightenment,
amen.
Closer to the truth. And that's what the ministry is really about. So if we can just hang in there together, support our pastor to do
amen.
This, there will be a time where it will all come together and we'll actually get to see what the Lord has had working all this time that is so hard for us to see now.
Amen. Amen.
Word of God says, you will reap. If you faint
yes.
not,
amen.
Glory to God. Glory to God. You will reap.
Yes, amen.
Hallelujah. Doesn't
amen.
Say, Brother Jack, you might reap. You may reap.
That's
you can
right.
reap. You should reap. It says you will reap.
Amen.
If you faint not. Paul
that's
said,
right.
be not
amen.
Weary in well-doing. For in due season you will reap. Hallelujah. Does anybody else want to share anything? I don't want to miss anybody. I want to give you an opportunity. Brother Richard, did you see yourself in those pictures? Because you were in quite a few of them. Oh, he was counting. Hey, I didn't see his little fingers down there. One, two, okay. I think that might have been me, so I counted for three. Amen. I had one picture of him I thought was so cute because he was in the foreground and his head was turned, you know, and you could see him right in his face. I said, oh, that's such a cool picture. So I included that. And then I hear Richard, was that me? Amen. All right.